Learn how you can use GitHub Actions with your SQL databases running in Azure this week on Data Exposed. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed. Today, I'm joined by Drew in the studios. Drew, thanks so much for coming into the studios today.
Thanks for having me, Anna.
Always a pleasure. And today we're going to be talking about GitHub Actions and SQL. And for folks who don't know a ton about this, I think this is going to be a great episode. We're going to show some demos and let's get right into it. So tell me about it.
Yeah. So if I'm a developer and I want to deploy my code to Azure or an environment, I can use GitHub Actions to build and then deploy code. I've been on the show before and talked a little bit about SQL projects, where you take your database code and then deploy it to your database. So basically, almost just like app code. For developers using GitHub Actions, you might be wondering a little bit about the configuration and how that impacts your best practices. And that's what I wanted to kind of talk through a little bit today.
Cool. Awesome.
The thing that I wanted to introduce is the ability to use different firewall settings on your database to do that deployment. With the GitHub SQL action, because it's hosted by default in Azure, if you do the setting for allow Azure services access, the GitHub action will be able to run as is. You don't have to worry about any additional configuration. So you can either use this GitHub action to run scripts or to publish a SQL project and make those changes. It's pretty awesome.
Awesome.
So the way it does this is either using the two fantastic CLIs that we have, either GoSQL CMD or SQL Package. Both of those are cross-platform, so we can use either Linux or Windows GitHub Actions runners, which is like whatever environment you have, you get to use it. The thing about allowing Azure services access is some organizations would prefer only to enable selected networks and then use firewall rules instead of doing all
right.
Azure services. It's just kind of one of those things where maybe if I want to move more towards best practices and a little bit less of a developer environment, I might start doing that. The thing about this server that I have here is I actually have no firewall rules created. Instead, I can use a managed identity or a service principal in my workflow and then run the Azure login action. When SQL action runs now, it's going to pick up that account and add a just-in-time firewall rule and then remove it just for that run.
Oh, wow.
So it basically just says, I only need a temporary firewall rule. I'm going to take care of my deployment, and then when I'm done, re-secure the environment.
Amazing. I didn't even know that was a thing.
So I can check out right before I came in here. I ran a quick deployment, and as we look at those logs, we can check real quick where the runner added the firewall rule and then removed it because we saw on the page that there's no longer there. So we're talking about minimizing our surface area.
And setting up the service principal, tell me a little bit about that. Is it super complicated? Does it work? Or
so it will take an AAD admin in your environment. But another huge benefit of this is you can use those kind of same principles of AAD service accounts for also your SQL authentication. So the connection string that you provide, the action, you can use that managed identity for the SQL as well. So you don't have to use SQL authentication.
Awesome. So it kind of just brings best practices through and through.
I know, like best practices all around.
Awesome.
The other environment that I wanted to touch on is a much more complicated one.
Okay.
Now, this does open us up not to just Azure SQL Database, but also Azure SQL Managed Instance or SQL in a VM. In Azure, you might be using virtual networks to provide enhanced security. Mm-hmm. It could keep resources off of the public internet, everything within that secure environment. What happens in this case is you don't use the GitHub provided runners. You can bring your own. And in this case, I followed a great tutorial that we'll have linked in the video for setting up Azure container instances to run the GitHub action. In this case, we're controlling the container. You, the user, are controlling the container. And so what I've done is added to my container SQL CMD and SQL package so I can run my deployment. And now I can use that same workflow, but instead it runs on self-hosted. So that completely isolated environment, no public access at all.
Wow.
But what happens is in that same network, I have this container app instance where it is able to run these deployments. It checks with GitHub, says, do I have any deployments? Then it does those all within that isolated network. And so in that same vein, we can see our isolated SQL deployment is able to run. It doesn't need to add any firewall rules, but the thing that's happening here is it's running on a self-hosted, it's running on that container instance. And so we're able to do deployments even without using GitHub infrastructure. We bring our own to ensure that we're in a more secure environment.
Wow.
That's a whole big variety of places.
Yeah. Yeah. So just so I understand the Azure Container Instance. So the Azure Container Instance is running inside our virtual network, which is why it has access. Yep. Now, when we spin up this action, does a new container get created and then we tear it down?
Yeah. So the containers themselves, we're paying per CPU second of when that action is running. When there's no action running, there's no containers that exist. When that deployment gets run, so if I say run workflow or if I push some mm-hmm. code in, that is what causes the container to get created, run, and then get torn down.
Got it. Cool. Awesome. Okay. Seems pretty straightforward. As folks get started with this, any tips and tricks?
I think the thing that I would share in like total candor
yeah.
is, you know, I have these nice like green workflows, but when you get started with doing automation and setting up these environments, they're not all green.
Yeah.
You're going to have some failures. Like let's see if I go to my just-in-time one. There's a couple of failures there too. So as you get started and you're working through the different gates, I know that it can be daunting to set up these best practices, but it's so worth it. Mm-hmm. So work through a few errors. There'll be a link to a blog post here in the video description that'll talk through some of these details so that you can get to really nice secure environments while still leveraging GitHub Actions to power up your deployments.
Awesome, cool. It's really exciting how we're kind of bringing SQL to meet the developers where they are and bring them the things that they need to keep that in their workflow.
Yeah, absolutely.
Awesome, cool. Well, Drew, thanks so much for coming on Data Exposed. To our viewers, we're going to put some links in the description for you to learn more, follow some tutorials, give yourself grace when you hit errors. If you like this episode, go ahead, give it a like, leave us a comment and let us know what you think or if you have any questions. And we hope to see you next time on Data Exposed.